Bonjour et bienvenue à l'Université d'Ottawa et ici au Centre d'études en politique internationale pour cette conférence du professeur Paul Robertson sur la guerre en Ukraine. So, welcome everyone here to the University of Ottawa for an event organized by the Center for International Policy Studies. Professor Paul Robertson will be talking to us today about the war in Ukraine. Professor Robertson, just recently the author of this brand new book, which you can get at a very low cost, apparently on Amazon, Grand Duke Nikolai Nikolaevich, Supreme Commander of the Russian Army in the First World War, and a very impressive piece of work, I can already tell. And without any further ado, I'll let Paul give us his conference. Thank you.
Thank you, Phil. Good afternoon. Thank you all for coming here today. Cette présentation sera en anglais, mais si vous voulez poser des questions en français à la fin, c'est bon. Je dois vous avertir que la présentation contient des images très graphiques. Please be warned that the presentation contains some graphic imagery. The point of this talk is to go through the main events and battles in the war in Ukraine, to analyze the composition of the warring parties and to determine the causes of the defeat suffered by the Ukrainian army in August of this year. And as such, this is a military presentation. I'm not really aiming to discuss the political rights and wrongs of what is going on. But before we do anything else, we first need to orient ourselves to a map. That's what one always does in a military presentation. There we go. So this here is Ukraine. And these are the provinces of Donetsk and Lugansk. And the towns we'll mainly be talking about are Lugansk here, Slavyansk, Kramatorsk, we'll talk about Krasnoarmeysk, Donetsk, Golovka, and Mariupol. Now let's just very briefly summarize the background to the war. The trouble began with a decision on 21st of November this year, last year, by Ukrainian President Viktor Yanukovych not to sign a deal with the European Union. This led to protests against his rule, which led eventually to his overthrow in February and the installation of a new government. In the eyes of at least part of the Ukrainian population, the new government was illegitimate, and protests against it soon began in the east of the country from 1st of March onwards. Government buildings were seized in a number of cities, but as yet the protest movement did not have much force, and the police were able to evict the protesters. Then on 18th of March, Russia annexed Crimea. This gave the protest movement in eastern Ukraine new momentum, as some people there now hoped that they could repeat what had happened in Crimea. In April, the protests turned violent. On the 6th and 7th of April, protesters occupied government buildings in the cities of Donetsk and Lugansk and seized weapons from the buildings of the Ukrainian security service, the SBU, who seem to have a staggeringly large number of weapons in there, of course. So at this point, the protest movement turned into an armed rebellion. At the same time, it took a new political form with the announcements of the creation of two new entities for Donetsk and Lugansk People's Republic. On 12th of April, anti-government forces took over buildings in the towns of Slavyansk and Kramatorsk. Among these were several well-armed men who had come up to Slavyansk from the Crimea and Kuban region in the Caucasus, led by a guy called Igor Strelkov. The connection between these men and the Russian state is somewhat murky. There is some dispute as to whether they were sent by the Russian secret services or were freelancers acting on their own. And I don't have time to go into that right now, but if you want to discuss that more in Q&A, I can. Suffice it to say that although some commentators viewed what was happening in eastern Ukraine as a repeat of what happened in the Crimea, there were some differences, as we can see in the first film. We have a number of films in. And this is the seizure of the police station in the town of Golovka on 14th of April.
Protesters are trying to take over yet another police station, but a video has emerged in the internet where a protester who was trying to replace the Ukrainian flag with a Russian flag apparently fell off or was pushed off a ledge by a police officer defending the building, and so the crowds are very angry there.
Gorlivka, they're storming the building, throwing rocks through the windows, and the police inside are throwing out smoke grenades and stun grenades. They're breaking down the door now.
Вилізайте з крови! С оружием, твари, мне засели!
Пошли за ним, блядь, коктейль Молотова! Горите, суки, горите!
That just gives you a flavor of what these building takeovers were like. Now, in Crimea, the takeover was very orderly and peaceful. This was, in essence, mob rule. Okay, so it was something really actually quite different. In response to the worsening situation, on 15th of April, the Ukrainian government announced the start of the anti-terrorist operation. This got in motion the next day with an attack on the city of Kramatorsk, and we can see that in our next film here, just for 40 seconds. Stop at one. Okay, so basically what happens here is that the local civilians stop these armored vehicles, and then they surround them, and the troops, not wanting to shoot on them, surrender. As a result of which, the rebels get hold of a whole bunch of armored vehicles. Okay, and this is the first time they get hold of heavy equipment, and the attack on Kramatorsk fails. Undeterred, though, the Ukrainian army decided to continue the anti-terrorist operation, sent reinforcements to the region, and fighting soon broke out around Slavyansk. This resulted in the deaths of three rebel militiamen on 20th of April and the shooting down of a Ukrainian helicopter on 25th of April. So the war had now begun. In May, a number of events took place which made the situation even worse. Most notably on 2nd of May, after clashes between pro- and anti-government protesters in Odessa, the pro-government side threw Molotov cocktails into a building in which the anti-government side had taken refuge. 40 people were killed as a result. And the spreading of pictures like the one you've got at the bottom there helped to galvanize support for the anti-government movement. Events on 9th of May in Mariupol further angered the population. On that day, the Ukrainian army moved into the city in order to recapture a police station which had been occupied. On their way back out of the city, the Ukrainian troops were confronted by angry crowds, with the results that you see here.
Макрожопые, блядь!
To speak Russian, excuse the bad language. So the Ukrainian army will be moving from the left to the right of the picture.
Давай, беги, пидор!
And you'll see a man with a blue jacket coming across towards that. In the background is the police station.
Пидорасы! Двоих ранили.
Over 9 people were killed and some 50 were injured.
Бандерьё, сука! Сдохни! Ебать, ещё одного ранили, блядь. Пидорасы!
Okay, that gives us a flavor of what happened. So these events happened just 2 days before referendums were to take place in Donetsk and Lugansk to recognize the Donetsk and Lugansk People's Republics. Unfortunately, these referendums did not pass peacefully. In the town of Krasny Armeysk, pro-government militiamen seized a polling station and then shot at locals who came to protest, killing one. By now, the scene was set for war. So let us halt at this point and describe the two warring parties. So you can recognize Ukrainian troops in battle, because the Ukrainian soldiers wear these bright yellow armbands. It kind of undermines the camouflage, but I think not being shot by your own side seems to be more important than being camouflaged. And Ukrainian armored vehicles have two white stripes on them. These figures I put up here are very notional figures taken from the
strategic, the military balance produced by the International Institute of Strategic Studies. They suggest a much bigger army than Ukraine actually has, because a lot of its equipment has just been sitting in storage for years and years and years and is not in fit condition. So if you look very carefully at these tanks, which I think are at a place called Artyomsk, you can see there's actually sort of plants growing out of them because they've been sitting there for so long. So notionally, for instance, 139 Hind helicopters. In practice, there were probably about a dozen which they could actually use. So on paper, a huge army, but in reality, it was much weaker. So, for instance, though notionally 130,000 strong, the Ukrainians found they had real problems getting any troops at all to eastern Ukraine, and were never able to deploy more than about 50,000 troops to the front. Now, to compensate for a lack of manpower, in March, the Ukrainian government created a National Guard, which at first consisted largely of volunteers who had been among the protesters in Kiev over the winter. These were given a couple of weeks training, handed a rifle, and sent to the front. Despite this lack of training, some of them have actually fought quite well. In addition, there's about 35 volunteer battalions which have sprung up. These are, in essence, private armies. They're privately raised, privately funded, privately armed. The best known are probably the Idar, Azov, and Donbass battalions. The Azov battalion, now called a regiment, in particular, has a reputation as being far right in its political inclinations. And its symbol, which you can see on that slide, is a mirror image of the symbol of the Galician SS division in the Second World War. They deny that this is a Nazi emblem, but it doesn't look good. The volunteer battalions have been accused of war crimes. Can we have the document there? So this is a report by Amnesty International, which came out about a month ago. So you just go down a little bit. It says here, that's all we need. Members of the Idar Territorial Defense Battalion operating in the North Lugansk region have been involved in widespread abuses, including abductions, unlawful detention, ill treatment, theft, extortion, and possible executions. Now, to be fair, Amnesty has made similar accusations against rebel forces. Undoubtedly, in rebel-held territory, there have been kidnappings, beatings, even murders. So both sides are guilty in this regard. Let us now turn to the rebel side. Together, the Donetsk and Lugansk People's Republics make up Novorossiya, or New Russia. And you can see on the left the official flag of Novorossiya, and on the right the battle flag, which bears a stark, striking resemblance to the battle flag of the American Civil War Confederacy, without the stars. Novorossiya is actually something of a fiction. Command and control arrangements are chaotic. Again, I don't have time to go into this in detail, but would be happy to say more in Q&A. Suffice it to say that units of the rebel army, by and large, act independently of one another. So we will look at each of them in turn. First, we have the Donetsk People's Republic, with their flag on the right. The most important forces I put down here. The first is the Slavyansk Brigade, based around those forces which fought up in Slavyansk. Then we have the Bezla group, that's under a guy called Igor Bezla in Gorlovka. Next is the Vostok Battalion. This was founded in Russia by Russian volunteers. They came to Donetsk in May, immediately got themselves shot up. And since then, it's been Ukrainianized, as the original Russian volunteers have been supplemented and overtaken by local volunteers. Next is Oplot. I think this was based around the former members of the Berkut, the Russian riot police. Then there's Kalmius Battalion, it's sort of the miners' division, so formed around miners in the local mines. That then brings us on to, and I'd say that they have grouped all these together or they're trying to group these together in like a proper army formations, like numbered brigades, 1st Brigade, 2nd Brigade, 5th Brigade, but I don't have exact orders of battle for that. We then have the tricky question of whether there are Russian troops fighting among the rebels. Certainly, there are individual members of the Russian armed forces taking extended leave in order to fight with the rebels. But are there actually formations of the Russian army? It's a difficult question to answer, and I'm going to be very non-committal. Certainly in August, 9 Russian soldiers were captured in Ukraine, and there are stories of dead soldiers being buried back at home in Russia. Analysis of Russian soldiers supposedly killed in Ukraine would suggest that they come from the 15th Motor Rifle Brigade and various airborne units, which together make up the 5,000 strong peacekeeping force. Clearly, some Russian soldiers have been in Ukraine, but I would caution about saying that large-scale units, such as entire brigades or battle groups or even the entire peacekeeping force, have been operating there, because the publicly available evidence does not allow us to make any good claims about the scale of the operation. Despite trying, nobody as yet has been able to locate large-scale units of the Russian army on Ukrainian soil. Okay. So like a lot of other things, this remains murky. All we can do is keep an open mind and treat claims by all parties with a degree of caution. This includes both Russian denials and Ukrainian assertions that they had to deal with a massive Russian invasion. We can talk about this more later if you like. Next we have the Lugansk People's Republic. I put down here again, as well as the units I've mentioned, there are a whole bunch of other militias. Okay, I've just put down the most important ones. The largest is the Zarya Battalion. Then there's the Prizrak Battalion under, or Ghost Battalion under Alexei Mozgovoy. The Leshy Battalion, which describes itself as Special Forces. I don't know how real that is. The August Battalion, which is largely a border control Dromov group, and the Cossack forces under Ataman Kazitsyn. The Cossacks have a rather poor reputation as not being very reliable in battle, and also of they've been accused by other rebels of looting and banditry. I can't confirm how true that is, but one can imagine it might well be. And just to give you a sense of what these guys are like, we'll have another little show of the Prizrak Battalion on parade. And despite their sort of dad's army look, this is actually regarded as one of the more formidable formations in the rebel army. Ragtag sort of look to them, a certain degree. So you can recognize the rebel troops. They tend to wear these black and orange ribbons of St. George. It's based upon the ribbon of the St. George Medal. And these ribbons are worn by Russians when they're commemorating Victory Day every May the 9th. So it's a bit like wearing a poppy for us would be, perhaps. Okay. But I've noticed actually more recently in the fighting which has been going on for Donetsk airport the last month, they've started wearing white armbands and leg bands. So who are they? Well, we reckon there's now 20,000 plus of them. Back at the beginning of June, there were probably 5,000. By the beginning of July, there were maybe 10,000. By the beginning of August, there was about 20,000. So it was a steady growth throughout the summer. Some 3,000 to 4,000 of these are believed to be Russian citizens. Some also are volunteers who've come from other countries such as Serbia, France, and Spain, Brazil, Afghanistan, all sorts of foreigners. And same is true on the Ukrainian side as well. The overwhelming majority of these guys, however, are Ukrainians, as described in the next snippet here by British journalist Mark Franchetti of the Sunday Times newspaper being interviewed on Ukrainian television.
3 недели провел на юго-востоке Украины, в самом, как он пишет, знаменитом батальоне ополченцев «Восток». Командировка закончилась у границы, где «Восток» понес большие потери, а сам журналист и его фотограф чуть не погибли.
Что это за люди? Вот какая там идеологическая подоплека? Что за мотивация?
Вы знаете, я, естественно, не эксперт. Я могу только говорить о том, что я сам собственными глазами видел. А то, что я видел, это бесспорно. Ребята, с кем я разговаривал, в основном это украинцы, они из или Донбасса, или недалеко от Донбасса. Есть маленький процент, который русские добровольцы. И я с ними тоже разговаривал. В основном это люди, которые не имеют никакой военный опыт. В основном это нормальные, обычные граждане, которые взяли оружие, они абсолютно уверены, что они защищают собственные дома, как они говорят, от фашизма.
На многих лицах в студии программы Шоу.
Okay, so The next video as well, up at the top, I'll just show you one more, and that's just a close-up to show you what these guys look, nice and close-up. Okay, this is of a militia in Lugansk, and as you'll see, that's kind of all shapes, sizes, ages. There's no real...
Я уже сказал. Сыну Миши, жене Кате. Я воюю уже третий месяц. Все отлично, я живу. Все отлично.
Я воюю за мой город Краснодон.
О, Краснодон, да.
И чтобы эта мразь сюда не прошла, поверьте мне. А я передаю привет Тюмени вообще.
Привет, Миллерова.
Жене. Всем привет.
I just showed you that to give you some close-ups of the faces so you can get a sense of the mix of people you get. There are also actually many women fighting in the rebel ranks as well as men. I've put pictures of some of them on this slide. This is the best known of them. She's a woman called Elena from Kramatorsk. She married in the middle of a war one of the most famous rebel commanders who goes by the nickname Motorola. And that's their wedding picture there. See, that's very strange. Anyway, it's just sort of a bit of war porn because we have that. So let's go back to the war. In May, this really began to heat up. The Ukrainian army assembled a force of about 10,000 around Slavyansk, which was held by a group of about 2,000 under Igor Strelkov, who you can see in the top picture there having one of his flags blessed in the local church. The rebels, interestingly, make a lot of use of Christian imagery, which they strangely combine with a lot of Soviet symbols. It's a very odd ideological mix of seemingly incompatible philosophies. Anyway, Strelkov's defense of Slavyansk turned him into something of a hero in Russia. You can see that in the picture below, 300 Strelkovites. Despite their superiority, the Ukrainians did not assault Slavyansk directly, but instead set about gradually blocking it from outside while the Ukrainian artillery struck the town and those around it on a daily basis. The result was some considerable destruction, which we'll see later. Fighting, though, was not restricted to Slavyansk. On 22nd of May, for instance, the rebel Bezla group attacked a Ukrainian checkpoint, killing 13 people, which at that point was the most fatal attack of the war. In early June, the fighting spread east to Lugansk. On the 2nd of June, rebel fighters attacked a nearby border guard headquarters, which they succeeded in capturing. The Ukrainian Air Force sent ground attack aircraft to assist the defenders, but one of the aircraft let loose a salvo of rockets on downtown Lugansk, killing 8 people. And images like that one helped to produce an upsurge in recruitment into the rebel militia. There is actually an extremely grisly video of this, if you're interested in that sort of thing. And it was very widely spread and helped galvanize opposition. Following the attack on the border guard headquarters, the Lugansk militia then moved on to secure the border with Russia. And on 4th of June, they seized a number of border posts. From this point on, the Ukrainian government lost control of its border, which became open for a flow of supplies from Russia into Lugansk. Despite this, all was not going the rebels' way. Large parts of northern Lugansk province and southern and western Donetsk province never saw any significant anti-government protests. So these areas up here and down here were pretty much free of protests. And as a result, the Ukrainian army was able to move rapidly to secure these areas without any resistance. Then on 13th of June, the Azov battalion recaptured Mariupol down here after a very short fight. From there, the Ukrainian army moved rapidly northwards towards Donetsk and then eastwards along the Russian border here, south of Donetsk and Lugansk. And the aim here was for a pincer down here and down here to regain control of the Russian border and cut Lugansk and Donetsk off from Russian supplies. Okay. While fighting continued around Slavyansk, the Ukrainian army also advanced towards Lugansk and towards Donetsk. Then on 20th of June, Ukrainian President Poroshenko called a ceasefire. This then, as you see on this map, was the situation as it existed on 20th of June. Now, what the thing you should note here is this very long, thin arm of territory controlled by the Russian, by the Ukrainian army. Now, you don't have to be a military genius to realize that this put the Ukrainian troops who were in there in a very difficult position because they had a very extended flank and they were a very long and narrow supply line, which was very easily interdicted. And in this case, the Ukrainian position was made much worse by the fact that the rebels controlled the key terrain in the area, a hill known as Sara Magila, which is roughly here. Just under 300 meters high, Sara Magila, which you can see on the left there, controls the surrounding countryside. During the Second World War, the Soviets invested a huge effort into recapturing the hill from the Germans, and after the war built a big monument there, which you can see. Sara Magila is therefore like a Donbass version of Vimy Ridge. The rebels took control of the hill early in the war, placing what little artillery they had there and using it to shell Ukrainian movement down that long southern corridor I just showed you. Throughout June and July, the Ukrainians attacked the hill again and again. We can just see one of the early bombardments of it here, just to give you a sense of what this hill was subjected to for pretty much 2 months on a daily basis. Just see a few seconds of this. You can see the monument, the obelisk just there, which at that point was still standing. The initial attack, which this was a film of, failed. So the Ukrainians then kept on at it for basically all the way throughout June and July. Okay, that's probably enough. I think that could give you a sense of what was going on. Finally, on 9th of August, the Ukrainian army managed to reach the top of the hill, and you can see some Ukrainian troops standing or sitting under what then remained of the obelisk. However, they did not manage to hold on there very long. A few days later, they were driven back down. And here we have another video taken shortly after the rebels gained control. And you can see it. The only guy in Ukraine knows how to shake a beret, anyway,
no? Мы продолжаем, как говорится, подвиги наших дедов, не пускаем их к нам домой. Это высота, это самая высокая точка Донбасса. С этой высоты можно будет, как говорится, продолжать свои преступные приказы. Хунта, если бы она сюда добралась и здесь установила свои установки, которые она каждыми днями бомбит, Донецк мирный, мирные города другие, то я думаю, от Востока бы уже ничего не осталось.
Okay, so the point is by controlling this hill and using it as an artillery observation post, the rebels were able to interdict the movement of supplies down that very long, narrow corridor and make life very difficult for troops in that corridor who were, in effect, cut off, okay, and very rapidly ran short of supplies. And that would be the genesis of the Ukrainian army's first major defeat. Now, people perhaps should have been paying more attention to that, but they were instead distracted by events elsewhere. On 1st of July, the ceasefire came to an end, and the Ukrainian army resumed offensive operations, advancing towards Lugansk and surrounding Slavyansk. Finding himself cut up, the rebel commander Strelkov decided not to stand and fight, but rather to break out. And on 5th of July, his forces withdrew from Slavyansk, breaking through the encirclement and then retreating all the way to Donetsk. At the time, this was seen as a great Ukrainian victory. In reality, though, it was a missed opportunity, and perhaps this is where things began to go badly wrong, because the Ukrainians allowed the enemy's army to escape, and that had fatal consequences later. And in the next clip, we can see the consequences of the battle for Slavyansk.
This quo of the conflict, the separatists have apparently abandoned Slavyansk, which has been their main stronghold for almost 3 months. They abandoned it yesterday. They headed south in the direction of Donetsk, and now the Ukrainian army has taken the city over, and the Minister of Defense is here to tell us what the situation is. We're going to head back into Slavyansk, which I haven't been in since I was kidnapped.
Президентом було прийнято рішення про відновлення активної фази по антитерору. В зв'язку з чим сили підрозділів по антитерору задіяні в повному об'ємі. І на сьогоднішній день ви бачите звільнені міста, місто Слов'янськ, місто Краматорськ. Починається відновлювати нормальне життя в цих містах. Ви бачили картинку в місті Слов'янськ, нічого там нема страшного. Ми маємо на сьогоднішній день не знищену інфраструктуру міста Слов'янська, міста Краматорська. Також хотів би наголосити про те, що відповідно до плану дій ми будемо проводити активну фазу до тих пір, поки на території Донецької, Луганської області не залишиться жодного терориста.
Okay. Як ви вважаєте, довго продовжиться?
Okay. The Ukrainian advances after the fall of Slavyansk created the impression that the Ukrainian army was winning the war. However, Clausewitz noted that the aim of war is to destroy the enemy's army. What commentators missed was the fact the Ukrainian advances did not achieve this in any way. In fact, throughout this period, the rebels were getting stronger as they attracted new recruits and captured an ever larger amount of equipment. Ukraine was capturing ground, but the military balance was actually shifting against it. Moreover, the rebels were about to do what government forces never did, which was destroy a significant part of their opponent's army in what they referred to as the Southern Cauldron. We call these things pockets, but I think cauldron's a nice, more symbolic word. The Southern Cauldron was that strip of Ukrainian-controlled land I pointed out, which ran along, the colors aren't very good here, it's that strip of land running along the border there, south of Lugansk and Donetsk. I think I've actually skipped ahead. I'll just go back a slide, okay? So after Slavyansk falls, the Ukrainian army advances very rapidly down through this area here, because there's a huge gap in rebel lines created by the withdrawal to Donetsk. And then before long, the Ukrainian army is at the border of Donetsk and on Lugansk, and it's threatening to surround Lugansk here. But again, as at Slavyansk, when they reached Donetsk and Lugansk, the Ukrainian army didn't assault the cities directly. Instead, it stood off and resorted largely to artillery bombardment, using towed artillery, self-propelled guns, multiple launch rocket systems, and eventually even ballistic missiles. As a result of this, several hundred people have been killed, and we'll just show some of the consequences of the shedding of Donetsk here.
Say hello to the woman. Okay, we change lens.
Вы Люда?
Да, Люда.
Валя, Валя.
Он, я не знаю.
Okay, so as I say, none of this actually resulted in the destruction of the rebels' army, which continued to grow. And then you ended up with the position that because the Ukrainian army had stuck itself down this big, long, narrow strip there, it was finding that it was running out of supplies and in danger of being cut off. By mid-July, the situation of Ukrainian troops in this area, what they called Sector D, was becoming critical. Short of supplies, they could do little more than sit where they were. The rebels lacked the troops to assault them directly. Instead, they stood off at a distance and shelled them. On the 11th of July, for instance, rocket launchers destroyed a Ukrainian camp at Zelenopolye, which you can see here. Now, actually, if you look at this carefully, I'm afraid the picture's not big enough, probably, but you could see they've been hit by some very accurate artillery fire, because the order vehicles have been hit, and then the area around it hasn't been hit at all. And this led to speculation that the rebels hadn't done this, that the Russian army had done this, firing its artillery over the border. And there is some evidence to support that conclusion, but again, like everything really involving the Russians, it's not very provable, right? So all I can say is, I don't know whether it's true or not. Okay, it's a possible. At the same time, the rebels also destroyed a Ukrainian artillery position, which we'll see in the next video, and there's something a little interesting you can see at roughly the 50th second point.
both been captured by the rebels. And here we are. Meals ready for eat, provided to the Ukrainian army by the United States. There we go, we can stop. Ukrainian troops at this point began calling relatives and putting things on Facebook and phoning TV stations back home, saying that they were being slaughtered and calling for help. This is a unique thing and quite new in war, where a soldier actually phoning the TV station saying, we're being slaughtered here, we need some help. But none was forthcoming. Now, according to one report I read at this time, the Ukrainian general staff had advised rapid withdrawal from this sector at the beginning of July, but was overruled for political reasons. Ukrainian territory, once recaptured, was not to be surrendered. The result was disaster. On 25th of July, the rebels finally cut through the narrow corridor linking the southern cauldron to the rest of the Ukrainian army. From that moment on, the Ukrainians were completely surrounded. Now, rather than seek to rescue the troops in the cauldron, the Ukrainian army now embarked on a new strategy to slice and dice the rebel-controlled areas into little pieces. The plan very nearly succeeded, but in the end did not, and in the process, the Ukrainians repeated the same mistake they'd made in the southern cauldron by advancing rapidly deep into enemy territory without regard for flanks, and finding themselves cut off and destroyed as a result. So as a first step, the Ukrainian army, again, the color scheme on this isn't really very good, but they attacked the, the other one, this one here, attacked the crucial crossroads of Debaltseve on 23rd of July. Then they moved southward in a long thin pincer down here towards the town of Shakhtorsk, at the same time as advancing rapidly northwards there. The idea being to cut Donetsk off from Lugansk. And indeed, the Ukrainian capture of Lugansk, at the same time I should mention as well, they also attempted to do the same thing at Lugansk with attacks around here and here towards the village of Novosvitlovka. This one, though, was repulsed. But the Ukrainian army did succeed in capturing Shakhtorsk, so for a brief moment, they cut it into two. And this was a moment of severe crisis for the rebel army, and added to the perception that they were on the verge of defeat. But as any follower of Yomini knows, the side which has internal lines of communications has a great advantage, and in this case, it was the rebels. So it was very difficult for the Ukrainian army, with the external lines of communication, to move troops around. Okay? But the rebels, it's not really not very far from anywhere to anywhere. So they were able to rapidly move what reserves they had from one threatened part of the front to another. And that's what they did in this case, sending them all to Shakhtorsk, every guy they could rustle up. And on 29th of July, they recaptured Shakhtorsk, and in the way, reopened lines of communications between the two halves of their territory. And in the process, they inflicted a lot of damage on the Ukrainian army, which, as you see, it really stuck its neck out on these really long, thin pincers. Meanwhile, the southern cauldron was reaching the end of its life. On 27th of July, 41 Ukrainian troops crossed the border into Russia and surrendered. Okay, so this is the cauldron as it is there. It's that little white area here. After this, it splits into two. There's one there and one there. On 4th of August, the troops in this section, all 438 of them, crossed over the border into Russia and surrendered to the Russians. On the 9th of August, the troops in the second section further to the west here broke out to the west, and some 1,500 of them escaped. But most of their heavy equipment was left behind. The result was that the rebels gained control of a very long stretch of the border all the way along here. They also greatly shortened their lines, because instead of having to defend all of that, they now only had to defend a little bit like that. So that meant they could release a lot of men to go elsewhere. And they captured a lot of equipment.
Did you destroy the equipment?
Not all of it was destroyed. I think as part of a deal, from what I understood at the time, part of a deal with, I don't know what these guys did, but the deal with these guys, which was struck between the Russian border guards and the rebels and the Ukrainians, was, we'll let you go into Russia and surrender to the Russians, because we know you don't want to surrender to us, but in return you mustn't destroy your gear. And that's the deal which I understand was negotiated. Okay. Needless to say, this victory went almost entirely unreported by the Western media, which continued to peddle the line that the rebels were suffering one defeat after another. I can talk all about the media's representation of this later if you really want.
So how did the warring parties compare at the beginning of August? Well, by this time, the Ukrainians had about 50,000 troops in theater, several hundred armored vehicles, and 200 plus artillery pieces. The rebel force had grown to maybe 20,000 with perhaps 130 armored vehicles and 50 artillery pieces, including rocket launchers. And we'll just, for the sheer hell of it, we'll give you a picture of it, show you what kind of stuff the rebels had got hold of by this stage of the war.
Ополченцев произвёл залп из 20 реактивных снарядов по аэропорту Луганска, где сидят боевые пункты.
Okay, that's all we need. Just to show you what sort of stuff they had by the beginning of August. Now, the point about this comparison is to repeat really what I was saying. That reports were saying at this time that the rebels were on the verge of defeat, but in fact the comparison of forces shows that the Ukrainians' advance in terms of territory had not actually contributed to diminishing the rebels' military strength, and that the rebels' military strength had in fact grown substantially. The Ukrainian side still had a huge advantage in terms of heavy equipment. Okay. But in terms of numbers of ground, because the Ukrainians had a much bigger tail, so a much larger portion of that 50,000 would not actually been fighting troops. So in terms of actual infantrymen, they were probably relatively even. The Ukrainians had a large advantage, though, still at this stage in terms of heavy equipment. But the gap was closing. Now, at this point, one may ask where the rebels got all these armored vehicles and Grad rocket launchers and stuff from. And the Ukrainian answer, obviously, is they got them from Russia. And in some instances, that seems likely. At the same time, though, one should not underestimate the staggering amount of equipment that the Ukrainian army managed to give away. And I think we failed to click on this one. But can you click on this picture here? Now, these are documents allegedly hacked from the Ukrainian Ministry of Defense by a notorious hacking organization known as Cyber Berkut. I cannot tell if these are legitimate, they might be forgeries, but if they are for real, they're really quite informative. What they list, it's by a colonel in the Ukrainian Ministry of Defense, listing gear which the rebels have captured from the Ukrainian army. And if we click down here, he summarizes each document, so we go down a bit. I only speak Russian, not Ukrainian, so my translation may be a little off, but basically this letter says, in the period 21st to 28th of July, the illegal armed forces, NZF, got hold of the following military equipment which belongs to the armed forces of Ukraine: 12 TC-64 tanks, 14 BMPs, 7 BTRs, 7 Grad rocket launchers, 2 S-9s, 3 2S-1s, 4 D-30s. And then you go down to the next, keep going down. Keep going down, there's another letter, there's actually 3 of these ones, so you go down to the bottom of the next letter, and you see then between 28th of July, 5th of August, the illegal armed forces capture from the Ukrainian army, 10 T-64s, 12 BMPs, 10 BTRs, 5 Grad rocket launchers, so on, so then there's another letter, and so on and so forth. So if these documents are authentic, I say that they're quite revealing about the generosity of the Ukrainian army. That said, there is no doubt that the rebels have received military equipment from Russia. They call this the Vayentorg, or military trade. The equipment comes over the border southeast of Lugansk. It's then sent to the town of Krasnodar, and then it's centrally redistributed out of Krasnodar. Although rebel sources say that the Russians have stopped in the last week. Apparently they're not very happy about the breaches of the ceasefire. I think, though, that Russian assistance, and I'm speculating here, was more in form of smaller items which could be easily concealed from prying eyes, such as anti-tank missiles, manned portable air defense systems, ammunitions, uniforms, fuel, medical equipment, and so on, rather than big-ticket items like tanks, many of which were captured from the Ukrainian army. However, the covert nature of the aid is such that, to be frank, we don't really know. Okay. So how much of it they've got and exactly what, I can't tell you. In mid-August, the rebels faced a second severe crisis as the Ukrainian army tried another time to cut the rebel-held areas in two, this time by means of a pincer movement aimed at the towns of Krasny Lunch and Myusinsk. So that's here. So what happens here is that there's an attack from Debaltseve south, another one of these long, thin pincers coming down there, and then a simultaneous attack up here to try and capture Krasny Luch and cut these two halves off from one another. Once again, these attacks almost succeeded, but once again, almost was not enough. The rebels held desperately onto Krasny Luch, then sent in reserves, and eventually pushed the Ukrainian army back restoring the connection between Donetsk and Lugansk. The Ukrainian offensive failed, and again, they had stuck their necks out into long pincers where they could be cut off and destroyed. And this is now what happens, okay? Because on the 40th, these guys have stuck themselves up here, right? And then what happens next is the rebels counterattack there towards the southern border and surround a whole another bunch. Okay. And again, the color scheme's not great, but you can see where the attack goes down there and creates a second southern cauldron there. So this happens on 14th of August when the rebels capture the Marinovka border post, which I'm going to just show you here.
Охуеть!
These are destroyed Ukrainian tanks.
Танк Т-64.
Мины.
Okay, that's enough. So, this, once again, of course, was unnoticed by foreign commentators. Instead, we had reports like this one, which came directly after this in the Globe and Mail. Kiev routs rebels. Okay, this was not, and the whole point of showing that last video, this was not what was going on. Okay, a very inaccurate view of the war was being portrayed in the Western media. Equally unnoticed as well was the fact that Ukrainian troops, if you can go back to the map, Ukrainian troops who tried to surround Lugansk had also managed to get themselves surrounded as well. So having failed to encircle Donetsk, the Ukrainian army now tried a more direct approach. Until this point, the army had avoided direct infantry assaults on heavily populated centers. Now it changed tactics and assaulted the town of Ilovaisk head-on. Ilovaisk is, I'm fed up with this. Ilovaisk is just here, there. And we can see a video of the Donbass battalion of Ukrainians, volunteer battalion, in defending a school which they've occupied in Ilovaisk. So the problem about fighting in cities like this is that you need a lot of troops to do it, and it has a tendency to really suck them in, and this is what happened in this case. They decided to assault the city head on, and then the rebels resisted, so they threw in more forces, and then that didn't work, they threw in more forces, so they kept on throwing more and more into the battle for Ilovaisk, and in the process they weakened their flanks. They stripped their flanks of men, and they also stripped their rear of all their reserves, so that there was actually nothing behind Ilovaisk. Exactly, so what you get is a mini Stalingrad happening, where the attacking force has all gone into the city, and they've left themselves open to being counterattacked on the flanks and being destroyed. And that is now precisely what happens. Okay, we can stop. So, about mid-August, I began to read in various blogs by Russian military commentators who have close contacts with the rebels. There's a guy called Elmurid, who was a big buddy of Strelkov. It's not his real name, it's something Armenian sounding. Anyway, he's very well connected, and he started pointing out around mid-August that a lot of equipment captured in the southern cauldron hadn't turned up at the front, and they started speculating about where was this stuff, what was going on, and the answer was it was being collected in Donetsk to form a counter-strike, to form a reserve. At the same time, it was noted that troops, experienced troops, were leaving the front and being replaced by new recruits, and experienced troops were going back to Donetsk to man this equipment, and news came in that about 1,200 rebel troops who'd been sent to Russia to get training on how to use this equipment had come back, okay, and then they, again, are assembled in Donetsk. So, what happens at this point, therefore, is even while the rebels are in severe crisis around places like Ilovaisk and Krasny Luch, they're not sending everybody in, okay? They're trying to pull together as big a reserve as they can to launch a counterattack. And on 24th of August, they struck, hitting the Ukrainian flanks west of Ilovaisk here, and then marching southwards along the border here, west of Marinovka, And as I said, these flanks had been stripped of men. As a result, the rebels immediately broke through, and within hours, they had surrounded 4,000 to 5,000 troops in a pocket around Ilovaisk and Vorossiyevka there. From here, there was now absolutely nothing there, nothing at all. A couple of French journalists tweeted that they drove all the way from Mariupol to Donetsk and didn't see a single Ukrainian soldier. Okay. So really, once they got through, the rebels were in free country. As a result, they then advanced rapidly south along the Russian border to the Sea of Azov and then turned towards Mariupol. The appearance of rebels down here created something of a panic in Ukrainian ranks. They imagined they were 100 kilometers from the front line, and suddenly here were all these troops. They could have come up with only one explanation, that the Russians had invaded. The problem is, when Western journalists turned up there a couple of days later, they couldn't find any Russian troops. This is why I say you've got to be a little skeptical about this. So a guy called Sean Rourke for The Guardian, who's always keen to find Russian troops, the best he could come up with was he'd spoken to an old lady milking a cow who'd said that her husband had been in the army and these troops were far too professional to be rebels. So I don't rule it out, okay? I'm just saying there's another possible explanation, which is that it wasn't an invasion across here, it was a breakthrough down there. In fact, the people they did find down there were troops of the Donetsk People's Republics who'd said they'd come down there. So I think you just need to be a little careful about some of these things. Surrounded, the Ukrainian army made a desperate attempt to break out of Ilovaisk. This was a terrible failure. Over 100 were killed and several hundred were wounded. Hundreds more were captured. And as Roland Oliphant of the Daily Telegraph points out in this final video here, huge volumes of equipment were destroyed or abandoned for the rebels to capture.
So we're some miles southeast of Donetsk, and this is the area that the Ukrainian military has been retreating through. We've been driving around, we're seeing evidence of a really panicked retreat pretty much everywhere we go. This APC was abandoned, it's not damaged, it might have run out of petrol, maybe the engine broke, and the crew who is running it just left everything. They've left their body armour, there's maps inside, local policeman who's showing around says they just scattered ammunition everywhere that's now been apparently picked up by locals. This gives you an idea of just the scale of the retreat and how fast the Ukrainians are running.
The disaster was not limited to the area south of Donetsk. Close to Lugansk, the rebels routed Ukrainians around the towns of Lutigino and Bielaya. And you can see in this picture here, this is at least a couple of companies, maybe an entire battalion of Ukrainian tanks have just been abandoned in a field. These aren't destroyed, they've just left them there for the rebels to capture. The rebel victory at the end of August made it absolutely clear there was no longer any possibility that the Ukrainian army could capture Donetsk and Lugansk. The best that they could hope for was to keep what they already had. With this in mind, the Ukrainian army or government in effect sued for peace, and on 5th of September, the warring parties agreed to a ceasefire. Now, since the ceasefire was agreed, there have been numerous breaches of it, with almost continual fighting around Donetsk airport and shelling in many other places. So it's more of a reduced fire than a ceasefire. That said, the scale of fighting overall is much lower than it was, and to date, the front lines have remained largely unchanged, roughly as shown in this slide. If, as is possible, large-scale fighting does resume, then the real point to look at would be this salient of the Ukrainian army down here, which is sticking into the rebel positions around the town of Debaltseve. And apparently there's a large Ukrainian force there which could, if there's a breakdown, total breakdown of the ceasefire, be used for further offensive operations. And of course then also the rebels would probably be trying to cut it off. It's very hard to determine exact scale of losses during the war. Here's just a vague estimate. Real figures may be higher. The Ukrainian army admits to about 970 killed in action, although authorities in the city of Dnepropetrovsk say they've handled 2,000 bodies. So the real number may be bigger than that. That would suggest at least 3,000 injured, and we know of 2,000 Ukrainian troops who were captured, 1,500 by the rebels and 500 who surrendered to the Russians. Ukrainian President Petro Poroshenko said recently that the Ukrainian army had lost 60 to 65% of all its heavy equipment it sent to the war, which is a staggering volume. Now, I can verify, because we've got photographs of them, 500 armored vehicles which were destroyed or captured. Those are the ones who actually know there's photographs on the internet and they've been listed. But of course, there may be many more which aren't photographed and aren't on the internet. So we're probably talking between 500 and 1,000 armored vehicles and around 30 aircraft and fixed-wing aircraft and helicopters. Rebel losses are unknown, probably similar in terms of killed and wounded, I would suspect. And around 50 armored vehicles we can verify having been destroyed on the rebel side, and about 200 taken prisoner. So in terms of prisoners and heavy equipment, rebel losses were actually only about 10% of those of the Ukrainian army. Civilians, it's hard to say. We know of around 600 dead in Lugansk, possibly a similar number in Donetsk. Then there's 300 or so who are on board the Malaysian Airlines, plus others here and there. So I'm going to make a stab at around 2,000. But that's only an estimate. So how does one explain the defeat suffered by the Ukrainian army at the end of August? The first explanation is Russian assistance to the rebels. Obviously, this made a crucial difference. Having said that, you shouldn't regard it as the only factor. As I've said, in August, there were maybe 50,000 Ukrainian troops facing 20,000 rebels, with the Ukrainian side having an even greater advantage in heavy equipment. So even if NATO is right in saying that there were 1,000 Russian troops in Ukraine at this point, it still didn't balance out the balance of forces, right? The Ukrainian side still had a big advantage. So even if the Russians were there in reasonably large numbers, the Ukrainians still managed to lose to a much smaller force. So I think that requires some additional explanation. For a start, the rebels were clearly more highly motivated. All of them were volunteers. Most were locals who believed they were defending their homes. By contrast, most Ukrainian troops were conscripts. And although some of them fought very well, others did not. So a number of Ukrainian units deserted en masse. So in early August, for instance, the 9th Territorial Battalion from Ivano-Frankivsk in the far west of the country, one day all got in its vehicles, the entire battalion, and drove home. Okay, this was not the sort of problem that the rebels ever had. Next, the rebels enjoyed the advantage of interior lines of communication. This enabled them to move reserves rapidly from one threatened sector to another, and so withstand Ukrainian attempts to cut the area they controlled in half. That said, I think the real explanation lies in errors committed by the Ukrainian army. Too much effort was put into seizing territory and planting the Ukrainian flag, and not enough on destroying the enemy's army. Rapid pushes into enemy territory without regard for flanks led to repeated encirclement, exacerbated by a refusal to withdraw when encirclement threatened. The result was that by late July, the Ukrainian army was already facing significant problems. The military situation was not nearly as good as it was being portrayed as. The omens of Ukrainian defeat were therefore visible well in advance and well before any supposed Russian invasion. And on that note, I conclude and invite your questions.
You essentially described two different battles. One is a military battle. You give a very different picture. And then there's a public relations battle, which you obliquely refer to. And it has a totally different set of vectors. And it just seems like such an incredible imbalance on the one side, on the military, just on basic military skills and sort of what you learn in, I don't know if you went to Sandhurst or whatever, but you know, yeah, basic stuff. And on the other side, you have an enormous success, which is about marketing and that sort of thing.
Success
and,
by who?
And the...
By who? You ask by who?
Well, it seems that what we see, the reporting you showed in the Globe and Mail, etc.
Okay, I can explain why you get by Western media reporting is not, this isn't something which is peculiar to this conflict, okay? I mean, if you study the way Western media study conflicts and world politics generally, you soon discover that it is often not very well. And you then have to start studying media studies to understand sort of why. There's a book I give my students called Flat Earth News by a Guardian journalist called, I've forgotten, something Davis. Which explains really the processes by which this happens. And one of the problems is that there are very, very few actual investigative journalists. And as fewer and fewer year by year, and there's more and more pressure to produce stories now. So what people do is they rely on press releases. So most Western media reports on the war in Ukraine will be based on briefings given by Colonel Lysenko, the spokesman of the Ukrainian army. And they'll say such and such, such as when lower down in the column, you'll say, says Colonel Lysenko of Ukraine. You see, so that is the way they are. That's just the way people produce news. Okay, personally, I don't think Colonel Lysenko is a very reliable source. But that's, you know, so that's why you get a slightly distorted picture, because he's going to show you the news as he wants you to see it. Okay, so if you just copy his press release, you're going to do it, and that's what most journalists do. They copy press releases. And so that gives the power to shape the story into the hands of the people who give the press releases.
Thank you very much.
I have a heart condition. Yes, congratulations for a very, very credible, comprehensive effort. Just a couple of very short commentaries. I've been a student of war all my life. I'm an old guy and having severe health problems. I would like to stress that what escaped notice up to now is that the outer defensive perimeter of Russia coincides with the borders of the Russian continental state in 1914. Anything that challenges this outer perimeter amounts to an acknowledged or unacknowledged casus belli, and that will include expanding NATO into the Baltics and, of course, what happened in the Ukraine recently. Why is this happening? Because since the late 70s, and obviously since the collapse of Berlin Wall, and that's my conclusion, very powerful actors within the European Union centered on Berlin and within the Russophobic Brigade in Washington, D.C., have decided to challenge Russia, ignoring that this could lead to conflict. One last point, being a student of war, I have lots of sympathy for the suffering of the Eastern Slavs. Since the Bonapartian campaign of 1812 and going through all the tragedies, Russo-Japanese War, Civil War, Bolshevism, World War I, the horrors of the campaign of racial annihilation that was conducted by National Socialist Germany, it's very sad to see Slavic people again being killed. To me as a person, as an individual, I found that extremely sad.
I think it's an extremely tragic.
Thank you very much.
I think it's an extremely tragic and an unnecessary conflict. I would disagree with you, though, in regarding it as a deliberate product of Western policy. I think Western policy is, my own personal view of Western policy is that we're stupid and misguided and we blunder, rather than that we have some sort of grand conspiratorial design to do down Russia. So that's just the way I view it. Do we have any? But I don't have a big debate about it, because I said this is meant to be a military briefing. I don't want to go into a big geopolitical discussion.
It's subordinated, Professor. You cannot have military strategy without the overall national.
Oh, you can. I mean, you shouldn't do it, but it doesn't mean you can't, because people are stupid. the next.
I'm Helena Mokrushina, and I teach sociology here at the University of Ottawa, and I have two questions. First question is about the prospects of creating a regular army for the People's Republic of Donetsk and Luhansk, or Novorossiya, because you talked about all these separate military leaders and the problem they have of, mm-hmm. you know, choosing, selecting one person who would, you know, unite them. And the second question is hypothetical. How do you think events would have developed if the ceasefire was not achieved? Thank you.
Okay, so the command and control arrangements of the rebels are extremely complicated, because basically some of them don't get on with each other, and they all like to protect their own little militia which they created, and there is no central command and control. So at the beginning of war, Strelkov was named Minister of Defense of Donetsk, but he really just commanded people in Slavyansk. When he came back to Donetsk, he tried to become Minister of Defense, but people just wouldn't listen to him. And he set up a military council, with the idea being that they would have a collective decision-making body, but it never really worked very well. And that is still pretty much how it is. They are now talking about calling a Vayenny Soviet, a military council again, to establish a single Novorossiyan armed force. The problem with that is that there's a lot of different political agendas involved. Different rebel commanders have different political agendas. There's personal rivalries, suspicions, people defending their own turf, and it's not very clear how they will manage it. There is a central headquarters supposedly in staff in Krasnodar, but I don't know how effective it is. So as things stand, there is no central command and control. But somehow they seem to muddle through anyway. And the prospects of creating central command and control, we'll have to see if anything comes out of this via the Soviet, which they come. If there had not been a ceasefire, they would probably, well, it's hard to say, they certainly would have attacked Mariupol. And they may or may not have, I cannot say whether they would have captured it, but they would have had a chance of capturing it. It is clear that the rebel commanders did not want the ceasefire. It was imposed upon them by Moscow. There are some of the rebel commanders who are happy with it, because I think they think they're maybe overextended. There are others like Mozgovoy who spend all their time saying that it's a sellout and a betrayal, and they want to march on Kiev at the first available opportunity. So I think if there had not been a ceasefire, the rebels would have had problems advancing much further than they have, simply because they were already very overextended. But there would have been a push on Mariupol, which may, which would have had a good chance of success. So in that sense, the ceasefire has favored the Ukrainian government.
It's not over.
Is anybody else who's not saying something? Yes, sir.
Yeah. What was the Russian motivation for demanding a ceasefire?
Okay. Well, as everything to do with Russia's involvement in this, we don't actually fully understand or know, right? Because it's all done behind closed doors and so on. But one has the impression that Moscow's aim throughout has been that these provinces remain part of Ukraine, but within a federated political structure. Okay. In mid-August, they forced Strelkov and various other people to resign because those guys were hardliners who wanted to march on Kiev and continue the war ad infinitum. And that wasn't Moscow's objective. So it changed the commanders and put in people who are seen to be slightly more amenable. And it didn't want the rebels to lose, but at the same time, it doesn't want them to win completely. Because if they completely reconquer the whole of Donetsk and Lugansk provinces and completely destroy the Ukrainian army, then they're an independent country and you're going to have, there's no way you'll get them to go back into Ukraine, right? So you want them to do well, but not well enough that they can really firmly establish their independence. I mean, this is sort of what one feels. Again, we're speculating, okay? So they've given enough support that the rebels were able to force the Ukrainian government to the negotiating table, okay? And they've created a position where if Ukraine wants to reabsorb the rebel territories, it would have to offer something, right? But not so much that these can be really, truly, firmly in control of their own destiny. That's my speculation. But it, of course, it is speculation because we don't know. There are also, of course, divisions within there are divisions within the Russian government. There are hawks, there are doves. Okay, the doves may have been succumbing to pressure to sanctions. Okay, but we don't know. Okay, but it could be the sanctions played a role, but it could be the sanctions made them more hardline. We really, it's very hard to judge the impact of thing, but they could have played a role in the ceasefire.
What happens now?
Bog's night. I do not like to speculate because every prediction I've made on this has been wrong from start to finish, and I think every prediction made by everybody has probably been wrong. De facto, they have won their independence in the areas they control. The Ukrainian army is not in a position at this point to reconquer them. Now, 5-10 years from now, if it completely rearms and retrains, it could try Chechnya too, and go in there and blast a place to smithereens and recapture it or something. But I mean, that would risk A, risk war with Russia, and B, would involve massive destruction, right? So we are left effectively with a sort of frozen conflict in which a de facto independent state has been created, but it's an independent state not recognized by anybody, and it's not really a state because it doesn't have, at this time, any functioning government. any functioning state institutions, any taxation, any law and order or police or anything. Okay. So what we're getting is a thoroughly disastrous situation, which is not good for anybody. Okay, it's not good for the people living there, because they'll be living in a dysfunctional state which is not recognized by anybody. Because it's not recognized, no one's going to invest. It won't have a proper state government. It will be dependent on Russian handouts. That will lead to corruption, mafia, blah, blah, blah. Okay, and you'll have Transdniester all over again or something like that. And it's not good for Ukraine, because then they'll have this disorderly statelet right next to it, and it won't be good for Russia because, well, but no one will want to recognize reality, so we'll all bury our heads in the sands and my, the, something else may happen, right? Maybe we'll negotiate a happy end to this all. But the most probable outcome is a sort of Abkhazia, Ossetia, Transdniester type outcome with a unrecognized proto-statelet which really doesn't function very well and creates all sorts of regional problems and is bad for everybody, regrettably. I don't know. But, of course, the war may start again. I mean, it could be that tomorrow the Ukrainian army or the rebels start a major offensive and the whole ceasefire collapses. Because, I mean, it is only a reduced fire. They've been fighting solidly for Donetsk airport for a month. The rebels admitted today they'd lost 80 men and 8 tanks taking Donetsk airport. That's 80 killed. Okay, and that's a rate of casualties which is as intense, if not more intense, than they were losing during the major fighting along the war. So it's this thing could go south. On the whole, though, I think that the rebels are dependent enough upon Moscow that although they're not fully obeying Moscow, they can't entirely rupture with it. So I don't think the rebels are in a position to suddenly launch a full-scale offensive. Okay. Yes, sir.
Have there been any repercussions on the upper levels of the Ukrainian military or their political system that you're aware of?
It's not really my area of expertise. The Ukrainian president is sticking with his defense minister, Mr. Geletai. It will obviously have an impact on the elections, which are coming along, the parliamentary elections. Who it will favor in those parliamentary elections, of course, I cannot say. I don't know whether we'll get hardliners or softliners or what. The one certainly negative effect, obviously it's had a very bad economic effect on Ukraine. The existence of these volunteer battalions probably creates a long-term law and order problem for Ukraine. I mean, what are they going to do with these guys when the war comes to an end? But in terms of its sort of higher level impact, I can't really say because it's not, Ukrainian politics is not really my area.
Thank you very much for both your passion and your very level-headed approach. It's really reassuring to see this all together and illuminating a lecture. You've already mentioned Transnistria and Ossetia, Abkhazia, but would you kindly make a reference to your top two or three lessons or things to take home from what has been going on? Thank you.
Depends who you're making lessons four, right? I mean, there's lessons for Ukraine, there's lessons for Russia, there's lessons for, you know, for us. I mean, in terms of a broad lesson, I think is a need for real before you embark upon, actually, the first lesson I'd say is perceptions matter much more than reality. Okay, this is the first thing. Okay, a major cause of this war is misperception on all sides. As Mr. Franchetti said, you know, these rebels really do believe they're fighting fascism. Actually, I don't think they are. I mean, I do not believe for one second that the Ukrainian government is a fascist junta, which is what they call it. Okay, but this is the point. You see the Pravi Sector goons, right? And if you're living in eastern Ukraine and you're brought up in a culture of the Great Patriotic War and on your grandmother's knee, she taught you about the Banderovtsi and then blah, blah, blah. And then you see a bunch of Pravi Sector guys going around and you see the Azov Battalion, right? You're going to believe that they're a bunch of fascists. So it's then incumbent upon people, I think, to understand, and this is another lesson, you must understand what image you project. And this is a real problem we have in the West. We simply cannot understand the image we project to others, because we think we are the good guys and our motives are good, and therefore people will think that we're good. Okay? And we cannot understand it, but people don't see it that way. Right? So we think that in promoting going when bad goes to Maidan, that he's supporting democracy and whatever, but he cannot understand that it's going to be seen by Russians as Western interference and Western attempt to bring down an elected government and cause chaos.
Okay. Breach of defensive
program. Okay, and breach of program, or whatever, right? So the first lesson, then, you know, is you, people have got to understand a bit better what perception they make on other people, right? So, you know, I don't care if the Azov Battalion, I mean, I don't know if they're really fascists or not, okay? But the problem is they look like fascists, right? So when President Poroshenko went to Mariupol and he shook hands with the Azov Battalion and said, thank you for your services for Ukraine, that's the kind of thing I think you shouldn't be doing, because it just creates a really bad impression, right? So that's the first thing. The second thing is, I think, and follows on from that, and I think this is, you really need to not think of things in black and white terms. As, you know, there's a good side, there's a bad side, good versus evil, and you must understand that things have local causes and local dynamics, and it's not all about geopolitics and everything. And you must understand that other people's perspective, even if you disagree with it, has some, you know, doesn't mean they're evil or bad, and doesn't mean you're good. Okay, and this is related to the last one. So, I think one of the problems the Ukrainian government has had is Because there's the talk about the Russians all the time, therefore there's an unwillingness to recognize and acknowledge any mistakes made by yourself. And then because of that, you blunder even further. Okay. So I'm a big follower of the whole sort of irrationality in foreign policy, Robert Jervis perception and misperception type of line. And I think the lessons to me are all along those sort of lines. Does that make sense? You have a lady there?
Your opinion of the interest of the United States in Ukraine, would they help to create this mess in the first place, would they help to overthrow the government in the first place, which leaked a conversation between Victoria Nuland and the Gates. So what, and you know that you say it's not about geopolitics, but I do believe it's all about geopolitics, that the cause of the war in the first place, so what do you think?
When we're getting on to the political discussion at the beginning, I was trying.
Because it is political.
Yes. I tend to view the Americans as blunderers rather than following this grand conspiracy. I would say that the American view of the Eurasian Union, which was proposed by Putin, it is regarded not as what I think it is, which is really just a form of regional economic integration, and as part of a multi-vector analysis. I think it's seen in some ways as a threat to global hegemony of the United States, and therefore there was perceived as being an interest in making sure Ukraine did not join up in this. America also has a ideological idea that, you know, the spread of Western values and so on is a good thing per se, and this leads sometimes to a mistaken pinning of hopes on people who say that they represent Western values. Just because they say they're Democrats, when you decide you're going to support them, even if they use undemocratic means, right? And this leads, this sort of ideological blinkers leads into, in my view, blundering rather than malice. Okay.
Don't you think it's all about NATO expansion?
Well, I would, my view on this whole thing, if we're going to get into politics, is that everybody's to blame, right? Okay, so the Russians are to blame, the United States is to blame, Canada's to blame, okay, the Ukrainian rebels are to blame, the Ukrainian government's to blame, okay? There have been horrible mistakes and errors by everybody concerned. Nobody has behaved well. Now, that is, my position therefore marks me out as something as an extremist in Canada, because I'm not saying it's all the fault of evil Putin, right? And therefore that is a position which is so bizarre, you know. But I'm not willing to go quite as far as you, I think. I tend to view that these kind of things tend to be the results of blunders by very many people. It's very clear, for instance, that I don't think the people on Maidan realized what was going to follow. Okay, they were naive in that respect. I think that the people who initially occupied buildings in Donetsk did not realize what they were setting in motion either. I think the American diplomats and Mr. Baird, who went to Maidan, did not understand what they were setting in motion. And they all behaved irresponsibly. So, you know, in that point, I agree with you. I think Western foreign policy has been reckless and irresponsible, okay? But I'm not saying it's solely the result of us.
All right, I think we'll thank Professor Robinson for a lively... And there is not time for one last question, unfortunately. So we're going to wrap up. Okay, there we are. Call me Lennon. Okay, so thanks, Paul, very much. And I'm sure he'll be around for a few questions.